Hi, welcome again to the class. In this lecture, we will understand the importance of machine learning and why is it required. So before getting into the topic, I'd like to give you an idea about how automation and machine learning algorithms have got evolved. So first, let's understand the landscape. Take for example, a simple automation system, how it behaves. There is an input, a process step, an output. An input can be of any data type. It can be a number, it can be a string value, it can be an image or any kind of information. That when it's fed to a process, it acts upon those inputs, takes decisions and gives outputs. So this process was conventionally programmed to operate in fixed ways. It cannot think of its own and make decisions. And it has very limited operating capabilities. So that was a bottleneck in the automation system. We were not able to extract the complete potential of computers. We wanted computers to behave as much as equal as compared to a human being. Human beings are conventionally good at thinking and acting on their own. So these were the problems with automation system. We are not able to make computers think like humans. So this gives rise to two different kinds of problems. One is problems that can be solved by humans and problems that cannot be solved by humans as well. Consider for the first case, there are problems where humans are very much good at, like identifying people and places. Whereas a computer is not that good at identifying things. It cannot read an image and identify information out of it. I cannot read text information and find meaning out of it. So these are problems with computers where human beings are very much good at solving it. The other kind of problems is where human beings also struggle to solve. Whenever there is huge amount of data, a simple 10 rows of Excel sheet, humans are good at solving it. Humans are good at even finding interpretations out of those numbers. But when we give the same to when we increase the number of rows and give it to humans, we fail at it. We cannot digest more amount of data. But the same task, when we teach a computer how to read those numbers, what to be looked for in the numbers, a computer can do much more efficiently. So wherever there is huge amount of data, humans are not able to understand meaning out of it, a computer can be programmed to operate and gain value from those data. So these two are problems using machine learning, how effectively we can solve. That's what we are going to learn. Because conventionally, there is scenario for huge data to be generated, and especially with advent of internet related applications. One key example is this data platform applications, which are rich in data. Example applications like Uber, Ola, Zomato, Swiggy, all online companies, wherever there is huge amount of transaction and two different parties are involved. One is producer and the other person is consumer. The producer sells some goods and the consumer buys it. And the platform or the online application appears as an intermediary. The role of this intermediary application is to maximize profit for both the parties and increase the number of transactions so that the commission for the online companies increases as well. So if you take a simple example of any data platform application, there are lots and lots of components present in that. Right from a mobile device communicating to its servers and internet connecting devices, there are lots of databases. Security aspects has to be taken care of. How good the application, what features the user likes in that application. So there are lots of components present inside that data platform application. And the data needs to be processed to optimize each and every component's usage and also maximize profits. So the complexity now increases. A human being cannot understand this much quantity of data. We need and to look for solutions. We are looking for solutions. Businesses are looking for solutions to improve and increase profits for each and everybody and create a win-win situation for the producers as well as the consumers. And of course, the data platform companies wins as well. So this complete thought process can be come down to a simple triangle called as business growth triangle. There are problems always existing. And the role of business is to find solutions and convert those pains into gain. And how it is possible is they are making use of latest technologies with help of people, researchers, develop innovative solutions. The skills are core for any companies with which they convert problems into solutions, and they make money and distribute, they accumulate wealth and distribute to others, and they gain as well. And just hold on to this for a moment. This business growth triangle is not just for business, it is applicable for individuals as well. And I would personally call it as personal growth triangle. How the triangle works, we'll get into it in a couple of minutes. So now coming back to the business area where machine learning is applied, there are a couple of other places. I wouldn't say a couple of, it is applicable each and every industry. Take for example, there are multiple industries present here. I've listed 7 industries here, and for each I have given an example where this, how this particular machine learning is helping in those industries. First, I'll go with automotive. There are self-driving cars being already coming into existence in the market. Most of the self-driving cars drive on its own based on machine learning algorithms or AI algorithms. Take for example, finance. There are loan distributions, loan applications are validated by computer programs. All those computer programs are machine learning and AI applications, which gives the first cut suggestions to a human being. Based on that, the human being validates and takes actions. The same applies for retail industry. To whom the product has to be sold, how much offer has to be given to that particular user. And also there are other innovative applications in retail. Like if I go to a shop and try out spectacles or a shirt, I can virtually try out different spectacles and see how it looks to my skin tone or which style I like it personally. Without even grabbing or without even going to a store, I will be able to do it. This is possible because of AI algorithms. And same applies for healthcare and media entertainment industry, even to energy sector as well. For healthcare, there is no need for an expert doctor throughout sitting in the hospital throughout the day. There are algorithms which gives the first cut diagnosis based on the scan report. Computers have become more good at reading diagnosis report and scan reports than a doctor. In media and entertainment industry, for handling, for reducing data transfer, intelligent algorithms to reduce data transfer are being developed. And also they efficiently route operations in the telecom industry. And finally, in energy sector, there is need for ever increasing smartness in each and every domain, and energy sector is no less. We need smarter solutions, when to switch on the light, when to switch off the light as well. There are lots of public resources making use of electricity. If we can make it intelligent, lots of power can be and energy can be saved. So the energy saved is money saved. So the same applies for each and every sector here as well. Now this is how machine learning is contributing in this case. The same setup, input, process, output. We are introducing performance and features to a fixed way of behavior in a program to an intelligent way of behavior. And how this intelligence comes is based on machine learning algorithms. So machine learning algorithms and AI are nothing indifferent than computer programs. Those are mathematical ways of operating which are implemented as solutions into a program system. So we'll definitely get to understand all those things as we progress further. So in short, I can say and borrow this quote from Stanford definition of machine learning: science of getting computers to act without being explicitly programmed. So we want computers to think on its own and make decisions. That is called as machine learning. That can be called as machine learning in this context. So before getting into machine learning, I would like to break some key words, or which are called hype words, that has been around there. One of the first word is called as data science. Data science is a broad term which encompasses multiple other ML and AI algorithms. So this is something like a bigger parent system, I can call. Under this data science all the remaining subtopics comes under this. So the art and technology of processing data and extracting information from that is called as data science. To achieve that result, primarily there are three different learning methodologies. As listed here, there are unsupervised learning, supervised learning, and reinforcement learning. To further understand those learning methodologies and how it works, we'll go to the first problem of unsupervised learning. In an unsupervised learning environment, we will teach the computer we will not teach the computer anything specifically. We will just give the computer some set of raw data. And based on raw data, we are going to extract some inferences. This is called as unsupervised learning. We are not teaching anything specifically to the computer, to the algorithm, through this method. So with the knowledge and working of algorithm, we will be able to extract some inferences. So an example of this inference, I would call the first method as clustering. In this method of clustering, I can group similar things together. So if I'm going to present a basket of fruits to my algorithm will be able to group similar looking fruits together. So the task of grouping similar looking items together is called as clustering. But the algorithm cannot identify what that specific fruit is or group is. It cannot name that group. It can only identify this group is unique. This is one of the methods of unsupervised learning. The second kind of learning method is called as supervised learning. In supervised learning, it's a little different than unsupervised. Here there is human intervention. In addition to giving the input data of different fruits, apples, oranges, and grapes, I'm also going to teach what that fruit is. So when I'm going to present this data to my algorithm, I'm also going to add my inputs, the fruit name. So here the fruit name is apple. I will give its properties, its dimensions, color, smell, everything. I'll give its properties. This fruit is called as apple. This fruit is called as orange, and the third fruit is called as grape. When I give this data, so it's not one single data. Here it is going to be hundreds and hundreds of data for each and every single fruit. Each and every fruit is going to be differing in size, its color, its smell. Not all oranges are same. There are different shades of orange. There are different sizes of oranges. So all these examples, different examples are going to be different data. All this data, when I'm going to feed into an algorithm, I'm going to get an output equation. For now, just assume it is an output equation which will be called as a model. This output equation, which is going to be called as a model, is going to help me identify future products. Or in this case, it is fruits. It's going to help me identify the fruits. Whichever I don't know, I have only measurements. I'm going to give those measurements as inputs to this model. It is going to again identify and predict what that fruit is, either apple, orange, or grape. This specific algorithm is called as classification. Okay. So the process of specifically identifying a category from a bunch of categories is called as classification algorithm. So this comes us to the second learning methodology. And now let's see what is the third learning methodology. The third learning methodology is called as reinforcement learning. Here there is no data involved, meaning I'm not going to feed a huge quantity of data like the previous two learning methodologies. Instead, I'm going to give inputs in form of two different formats. One is rules, and the second is state information. So here first let's understand what is state information. Consider a virtual environment where there is 5x5 box in which I'm going to place one car in single cell. So that is going to represent one particular state. There can be multiple different states. The car can be in any different cells. It can be vacant or it can be occupied. These can form the states in this particular environment. And there are rules. Rules like the car cannot turn left, turn right, the car cannot collide across the median. These can be the rules. And the possibilities the car can navigate is n different possibilities, n cross n. So here it is 5 cross 5, 25 different possibilities. It is going to try out each and every possibility at every single time. And for whichever action, my rules are going to be rewarding. For the outcome of rules and states, there is going to be third called as actions. Like for every action taken, the car's movement, there is going to be rewards, either positive or negative rewards. So that positive or negative rewards will be taken into consideration and it will be continuously refined over a period of time. So only if the car successfully navigates the path that it is expected out of it, it will be getting the maximum reward or it will be achieving the goal. So usually the goals are defined. In this case, we can define a goal like the car has to navigate from its current position to top left, pick a person there and then drop him in the top right corner. So to achieve this goal, the car travels throughout the environment in multiple directions, and whenever the car finally gets to that specific route, it gets the maximum reward. So it has learned, the car has learned, only if it navigates in this specific way, it can gain profit. So it will keep on doing repeatedly again and again in the same environment. Here there is no data involved, only these three things are involved: rules, state information and actions. So this explains reinforcement learning. The next term or the terms what we have seen so far are basic algorithms. Clustering, classification are the two things what we saw before. The next term here is regression. Regression is almost similar to classification. If you recollect, the classification is identifying a category from a bunch of classes, like identifying a fruit, identifying a specific fruit from a basket of fruits, different fruits. That is identifying a categorical information. Whereas in case of regression, it is identifying a continuous number. It is a continuous value. Right now, if it is not clear between a categorical information and a continuous number, do not worry. We will get into the data types in the next lesson. The different data types, what is present and what we will be handling in machine learning will be presented in the next lesson. Right now, it is identifying a continuous value. Continuous value can be anything from a sensor measurement to a decimal value. Height, weight, all these are examples for continuous value. So using prediction, we can identify a future continuous value. So how these algorithms are working? The basic algorithms, whatever listed so far, how these are working? These are working by making use of mathematical principles and statistics. Statistics here can be grouped on three different categories based on whatever is required in this world of data science. So the world of data science requires statistics in each and every place. So that is the reason we have categorized it to three different places. The first is descriptive statistics. It purely operates on the data we have and it produces inferences. It does not predict the future. It just says or explains as is what is there in the system. That is descriptive statistics. An example would be mean, median, mode, variance, standard deviation. All these are examples for descriptive statistics. Not limited to these things alone. There are additional or an exhaustive set of theories using which we can prove something is right or wrong. Those we will call it as hypothesis testing. There are different kinds of testing, hypothesis testing, which one works better, which one has a higher chance of success or failure. All these things will make use of descriptive statistics. And the second is predictive statistics. The predictive statistics is made use of in clustering, classification, these two kinds of algorithms, or most to be precise, in supervised and unsupervised learning, whatever mathematics or statistics it makes use of it, that we will call it as predictive statistics. It is going to predict for an unknown input what can be the outcome. That is called as predictive statistics. Third category is called as prescriptive statistics. This is same as predictive, but it just differs slightly. In prescriptive statistics, it is getting or taking additional actions on top of predictions. So it is mostly employed in a business environment, in a specific business application. Whenever there is a prediction, and based on the prediction, we have to take certain actions. We need to develop additional business modules or applications surrounding that. Such a kind of system is going to be called as prescriptive statistics. So these are the different kinds of statistics which we will have to know about them as well. So we'll see one by one slowly what are the algorithms present inside that and how to understand and learn further of that as well. And now learning this is how much useful to us. This is the triangle what I was speaking a few minutes back. Similar to business growth triangle, there is a triangle called as personal growth triangle, where we as humans have to convert our own problems into our own personal gains. Like, we have to reach our goals. In this case, it can be like developing a new skill, or we will have to go from current career level to the future career level. To reach our goals, we will also need new skills, both soft skills and hard skills. Hard skills here are some things like putting into use practically, like writing a program or business presentation. It can be from leadership skills to programming or hardware skills. Soft skills are interpersonal skills like leadership, emotional intelligence. All those things comes under soft skills. So we make use of those skills to reach our goals. If we take the business process triangle, there the company looks for key technological skills and also leadership skills. The same we need to have in our own triangle as well. Only then the company's vision and our personal vision will match together, and we will be able to contribute and grow along with the organization, right? So this is the content for this particular video lesson, and have your questions and discussions in the comment section below. We'll meet in the next video lesson shortly. Thank you.